Well, that, of course, was The Entertainer by Scott Joplin. I always refer to it as the new national anthem of ragtime, just as the Maple Leaf Rag was the original national anthem of ragtime. Next, we're going to play a piece composed by two composers, Louis Chauvin and Scott Joplin. It's called The Heliotrope Bouquet, and very interesting circumstances of its composition or creation. On the way to New York, Joplin was moving from St. Louis to New York in order to write his opera, Tremonitia. He stopped by in Chicago to visit his old friend and colleague and student, Louis Chauvin, who was considered by the ragtime pianists of that period to be the greatest of them all. Even Joplin had great reverence for Chauvin. But he was a kind of wastrel talent. He lived the good life and unfortunately died at the very premature age of 24. And there are very few works left of Louis Chauvin. And when I say few, I mean one or two songs. And this one piece, half of which he composed. The first half of this Heliotrope Bouquet is by Chauvin, and the second half by Joplin. What happened was that when Joplin visited Chauvin, he played for him some music and said it was a rag that he was working on and he hoped to finish. Joplin saw right away that Chauvin was not well and was so impressed by the music that he heard that in the next days and weeks, he finished the rag. And it is lucky that he did, because Chauvin died within a few weeks after this event. And so by Joplin completing the work, he preserved this little gem of music, which is the only testimony to the great art of Louis Chauvin. So a lovely work with a lovely title, Heliotrope Bouquet. I mean, that's got to make it good right away. One of those poignant lyrical pieces which you find so often in ragtime literature. Heliotrope Bouquet.
Thank you.
stayed with another pupil and apprentice of Joplin's now, and this is Arthur Marshall. Joplin was not only a great composer, but a very generous-hearted man, and he took these young ragtime kids, you know, with stars in their eyes, into his home, actually, and taught them and even helped to get their music published. In those days, publishers were not too eager to take any risks with young, unknown composers, particularly if they were still in their teens. So what happened very often is that the master or the most famous composer in that field or genre would add his name to that of the real composer of the work. So in this case, it's Arthur Marshall hyphen Scott Joplin in order to get it published, although the piece is entirely written by Marshall. And it's one of the most delightful of early ragtime pieces, very evocative of the kind of nostalgia of that period, the early decade of this century. The piece is called Swipesy Cakewalk. So much for some of the pupils of Joplin. Let's return to Joplin now for it's not a rag, a piece which is considered by many of the jazz authorities and ragtime aficionados perhaps to be Joplin's greatest piece. As I say, it is not, strictly speaking, ragtime piece. It is a tango. It's called Solace, and is one of the most beautiful and poignant of Joplin's works. It was featured to some extent in the motion picture Sting as a sort of mood piece at certain points. So this Spanish or Caribbean-influenced music, which you find a lot in early jazz, and as you may recall, in the St. Louis Blues, there is even a kind of tango section. This was a very pervasive element in the music of the South and of the Negroes and of black music. So here it shows up in Joplin's works. We'd like to play for you now, Solace.
Thank you.
You appreciated our three-handed drummer in the back there. You'll hear from him again later in the program. We'd now like to play a rag from sort of not the final days, but towards the end of the ragtime period, when lots of young ragtime composers came into the field, and this composer's name is Rob Hampton. And you begin to get all kinds of influences from different kinds of music coming into ragtime. In this case, for example, in very close juxtaposition, you'll hear music that will remind you of a Hungarian gypsy orchestra, and 3 seconds later, you're hearing piano virtuosic figures which could come out of a Beethoven sonata or a Czerny etude. It's very interesting how eclectic this music became in the final days. Particularly, I guess, germane because America is the great melting pot of, you know, socially and racially, and of course musically this manifests itself as well. So here you have a lot of musics coming together in one piece. The work is called the Cataract Rag, I guess referring to those cascading figures that you will hear in the piano, by Rob Hampton. Thank you. even more eclectic mixture of influences you'll hear now in the next piece called Dizzy Fingers, a title you probably know and remember, some of you. Maybe some of you even tried to play that piece on the piano years ago. The composer's name is Zez Confrey. Zez Confrey wrote Kitten on the Keys and Dizzy Fingers and almost overnight became a millionaire with the success of these two, what they used to call novelty tunes. And they are, this was in 1921, so this is the last stages of ragtime. Jazz has already come in, there's a new music on Broadway, and there's many American musical influences coming together. The piece that we're going to play for you, as I guess I've mentioned, is Dizzy Fingers, which was the most virtuosic and technically most demanding of all the pieces that he wrote. And it's a very curious part of this man's history that he became a very wealthy man through the sale of the sheet music of this music, although nobody could play it because it takes really a very trained pianist. But I think it was de rigueur to have this music sitting on the parlor piano, you know. It was a sign of a good home or something. In any case, we'll play it for you now, Dizzy Fingers. Final composer of the evening, we want to present to you the music of James Rhys Europe, a name you've probably never heard before, but in my opinion, and perhaps a few others, he is one of the great American composers, unfortunately and inexplicably very much neglected. He is a contemporary, more or less, of UB Blake's and Joplin's. He revolutionized popular music around the time of World War I, particularly in New York City, where he lived and worked, and had a very interesting career. It would make a good opera, or a good drama, or a good play. He first came to some notoriety when he took an all-black orchestra from Harlem, swooped down to 57th Street, and invaded Carnegie Hall with his orchestra. It consisted of 150 musicians, but since it wasn't a regular symphony orchestra with all the proper instruments of symphony orchestra, there were in it many odd instruments, like 20 banjos or 30 mandolins, and 10 pianos he had, and then also some instruments which are hardly known anymore today, kind of hybrid instruments like the harp guitar. You ever heard of that one? And the mandicello, which was a cross between a cello and a mandolin. And he had lots of these, and so it was essentially a plectrum, or plucked instrument orchestra. He played classical overtures and ragtime and some of his own compositions, and really astounded the musical establishment of that time. I wonder what Walter Damrosch must have thought of that orchestra. Then he teamed up with the famous dance team of Irene and Vernon Castle, who in their own right revolutionized social dancing in the United States around the time of World War I. He became their musical director and provided the orchestras for their many exhibition dances, and also wrote a lot of the music associated with them. And as you may know, they invented such dances as the Foxtrot, which became, of course, world famous. And Europe wrote the music for these pieces. And we will play for you two pieces from that period of his activities. Then World War I broke out, and somebody in New York had the idea that one ought to put together an all-black military band. And Jim Europe was given the assignment of putting this group together, auditioned for about a half a year all over the United States. And by the way, when he couldn't find black musicians on some of the instruments, like oboe and French horn, he would go to Puerto Rico or to South Africa. I mean, he didn't go there, but he imported musicians from there to complete the roster of this band. They went along with the expeditionary forces to France. They were called the Hellfighters Band. They acquired that nickname and were a fantastic success both with the French population and with the American troops. They were kind of early Bob Hope USO unit, playing for the soldiers in the front lines and entertaining the population of the country, France. General Pershing heard of, got wind of this band, but because it was a wind orchestra, well, that's a bad pun, heard of this group, and it almost became Pershing's personal military band and accompanied him to all important functions and meetings. And when the war was over, Jim Europe was accorded a ticker tape parade on Fifth Avenue with his whole band, which is a rather special occasion for a musician. Then he decided to capitalize on this various successes and take an orchestra, a newly formed orchestra, around the country on a grand tour. John Philip Sousa had been touring with his band all over, and he thought he might become the Black Sousa and emulate the great March King. Well, then his life came to a very abrupt end in Boston, of all places, where during a concert, he was murdered, knifed to death by one of his own musicians, the drummer in the orchestra. They had a tiff, a musical argument, and he cut him in the jugular vein, and he died before the night was over. And thus, we lost one of the great geniuses of American music, who could have been perhaps another Gershwin or something like that. He could still be alive. He was only 2 years older than UB Blake, so he could still be with us. And it's interesting to speculate on what further great achievements this man might have had. He was in his 30s when he died, and so it was a great loss, and perhaps this accounts for the fact that he is now forgotten, but I think his music should be revived, and so we've been trying to include him in our programs. And indeed, these pieces are so exciting that they always constitute the finale of our programs. And as you listen to this music, you might imagine yourself dancing to these pieces. They are played at tremendously fast tempos, so imagine your heels kicking along with this music. I should also mention that the final work of the two we're going to play for you, Castle Walk, associated with the castles, of course, and Castle House Rag, features some virtuoso drumming in the fashion in which Jim Europe's own drummer, Buddy Gilmore, played these solos, a great virtuoso drummer. And of course, this will be played now by our own drummer, Mark Belair. So here we go with James Europe's Castle Walk and Castle House Rag to end our program proper. Thank you.
James Reese Europe's Castle House Rag, featuring the three-handed drumming of Mark Belair, eliciting a standing ovation for Gunther Schuller and the New England Conservatory Ragtime Ensemble. And I believe we're in store for an encore.
That's too irresistible, so you're very kind. And since you're in a clapping mood, we're going to really put you to work. Because we have a piece by Scott Joplin, it's called The Ragtime Dance, in which the players or the audience are asked to participate by hand clapping and foot stomping. And we've got a nice cement floor here so we can really hear what you're doing with your feet. Now, there's one provision, though, and that is you must follow the conductor. All right? And that's me. Now, hang on, and I'll conduct the whole assembly here. All right? Ragtime dance. Thank you. one more piece to play for you.
That's very... Thank you. But you'll be surprised to hear what it is. I should tell you, perhaps you don't know, we have just come back from a four-week tour in the Soviet Union, where we were a wonderful success, and we had a marvelous time meeting with the musicians and the people of the Soviet Union. But it is so good to be back that that we'd like to play the one piece which represents the epitome of American music all over the world, and which is the only piece with which can possibly top all the other music that we have played today. And I won't even tell you the name because you'll recognize it right away. Here we go.
And another standing ovation from Maestro Schuller and his group of talented young musicians, John Philip Sousa's Stars and Stripes Forever, concluding this concert of American music featuring Gunther Schuller and the New England Conservatory Ragtime Ensemble. This concert was recorded June 26, 1978, by Jerry Womer and Paul Keller of member station WUHY in Philadelphia. Our post-production engineer has been Jay Goldman. Special thanks to Fred Landerl and Susie Meissner for their production assistance, as well as to Bob Dustman, Mike Gallagher, Rich Jehenning, and the technical staff of The Grand. I'm Leanne Hansen, speaking to you from the Grand Opera House in Wilmington, Delaware.